that there's a Savior. He found me lying in my grave. One word, just one word, I heard redemption call my name. Now that I've tasted living water, there is no turning back for me. You are, yes, you are the only reason that I'm breathing. I wanna tell the whole world about Jesus. He saved my soul.
Helping us do in the nation of Guatemala. You have seed in that nation. How cool is that? Amen. From this place, you're touching the nation of Guatemala. Amen. You have seed in that. And I just got to say thank you to your pastors every December. I know it's a hard time, you know, churches, you got activities, you know, parties, and it's end of the year. But it works in our schedule to come back to the States, and we graduate our school in October. So we come back, and I hit the ground running in middle of October into December. And it's such a big blessing to me for a pastor to open up their platform and let me come and share the Word of God. And it's a tremendous blessing that you come. Because I'd preach if one just came, but it's nice to preach to more people. Hallelujah. Praise God. But I just said thank you. I mean, no, you got good pastors. Amen. And they are just good, good people. So did I say that okay? Do you want me to say it? No, they didn't tell me to say that. But again, thank you very much for allowing me to come. And over the years, I don't know if it's mine or yours or somebody's is going off. Somebody's. I think I'm tied into the internet. Here for some reason, because I used to stay up there. I think I must be on the internet. Mine just went off, and I thought, okay, what was I saying? I have no idea what I'm talking about now.
Talking about how good the pastors were.
No, we moved on now. We moved on. We're on Guatemala. But I've been coming here for the past several years, and your pastors have been very generous and very gracious to us. And I apologize, my wife could not be here. We divide and conquer, and so she's in Tulsa, seeing the other set of the family, the kids there in Tulsa. And I've got to just, you know, I'm going to show you some pictures. And but can I just give you just a personal shout of victory? Can I do that? I'm going to do it anyway, so I just thought it'd be nice just be nice. But many of you know, I've told you over the story, over the years, and then we first moved to Guatemala, our middle son, Bryant, ended up having a brain tumor. I don't know if some of you heard that story. We just moved to Guatemala. We got there on fumes, and the bottom fell out. He was sick, and we didn't know what the problem was. We got him to the States. He ended up having a brain tumor. And so he went through a 12-hour surgery, and they got most of it. And then he ended up in St. Jude, there in Memphis, Tennessee, wonderful hospital, started by the late Danny Thomas, tremendous hospital. He went through the chemo and the radiation, and they said he'd never go back to Guatemala. A year later, he was living. back in Guatemala. How many know God is a good God? Amen. A year later, he was beat cancer. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, just in September, we've gone through the, you know, we come back every 3 months, every 6 months, every year. And he's come back and gone to Oral Roberts University. He did a double major in 3 years. I mean, you know, just a tremendous thing what he did. But he just went in September to St. Jude for his 10-year checkup, and he's done with St. Jude. No cancer, no sickness, no disease. The power of God. How many know God is good? Amen. And what's a personal testimony on my part is this. We got them back to the States, and they got the tumor out in Tulsa, and then they went on to St. Jude, and I had to go to Guatemala to take care of some business. And then when I was there, we didn't know what all this meant. But the doctor that Bryant had called me, and he said, your son and your wife's in the room. We just had a consultation. He said, I'm going to tell you, we're going to put our boxing gloves on, and we're going to beat this. We're going to beat it with the Word of God and medicine and prayer. How many know God's good? Amen? And so Bryant had this doctor the whole time, and I didn't bring that picture, but he wanted a picture with Bryant because he said, I don't get to see a lot of the kids make it all the way. I mean, oh, God is good. Amen. And your pastors and many people, I mean, your pastors were very gracious and very loving during that time. They supported us, and I mean, oh, God is doing miracles today. Amen. Now, I'll just go on. If you'll pop up that first picture, we'll show you a little bit of what we're doing, what you're helping us do in the nation of Guatemala. Our primary focus is that we are ministers of the gospel. I mean, the gospel will change people's lives. Amen. And that's what we're doing. We're preaching, ministering the gospel. And so what we do is we train ministers, we train nationals to do the will and plan of God for their life. And this class represents 7 different churches. And every one of the students are involved in ministry. Some of them are music ministers, associate ministers. There's a few pastors and a pastor's wife and a lady pastor this year. And so we charge a little bit for the school. That way they have a little bit of investment. But really what we charge doesn't really cover the books and the things. And then we don't make anything. We don't, you know, it's just what we do in Guatemala. And but if you're a pastor or a pastor's wife, we don't charge you anything. You come for free. And just our seed into you. And so the school year runs from February to October down there. We follow that school system. And so we just graduated in October, our 9th graduating class. Hallelujah. And so next year, we're kick off again in February. And so we have a first-year program and a second-year program. And we've been going for 9 years now. And so we got a lot of graduates out there, and they've been wanting to come back and do a third year. And so we're praying about it. We think we got it figured out how we can do it. We're going to clone me. No, not really. Clone my wife. She's a better teacher. But anyway, we figured we got it out. And so we're going to do a third-year program. That's what we're praying about and believing God, and if we can get everything lined out. But let's go. Let me just tell you who on the front row. If you start from this is my left, right, and this side over here. That's my son-in-law. My daughter got married last year, and they live in Guatemala. And so I told him, if you got to pray and make sure it's the will of God. And if it's the will of God, you got to marry my daughter and move to Guatemala. Well, he's living in Guatemala. I said, my daughter lives in Guatemala. Okay. So he come to Guatemala, and he's really a good young man. God really gave her a wonderful husband. He's got a tremendous heart. He loves Jesus. He loves my daughter. He can preach. He can sing. And he's got a very humble heart. And he shares my birthday. Same birthday as mine. Not the same year. But the same birthday. And somebody said, his name is Tyler. And somebody said, well, Tyler has your birthday. I said, No. It's my birthday. You know, he shares it with me. You gotta get it first now. And then there's my daughter. Then there's a couple there, the lady in the red and the guy next to her. They're pastor in Colorado, good friends of ours. We went to Raymond with the husband there, with Mark. And so they came and did our graduation. And you saw in the video, there was a nice, really nice banquet. What we do is we have a graduation on Friday night where we honor the students with the diploma. Then on Thursday night, we go to a very, very nice hotel and we do a dinner where we celebrate what God has done in their life. And my wife and I, we just take care of that bill. We don't even charge anything, and they can bring a family member or whatever, and we just have a night where we celebrate them. Then the next night, we honor them with a diploma. And so the pastor, Tasha, there in the red, she came and did the banquet, and then he did the graduation and also preached in the church that we go to. And then there's myself and my lovely wife. Let's go to the next one. And there am I at graduation where I'm giving a charge to the students to go out and do the will of God, or I'm going to kick you in the pants. Hallelujah. And then there's our translator, Laura. Let's go to the next one. And there are two of our graduates, Andres on the left, that he is a second year, and then that's his sister beside him, and she was a first year. And then the year last year, his mom and dad went second year. And so we got the whole family. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's go to the next one. And this is one of the volcanoes that we have in Guatemala. We're surrounded, in our city, we're surrounded by three different volcanoes. And believe it or not, one is active. I mean, actually, you can see where the lava would come down, where the trees and shrubs are not there. The lava was it would shoot up, and then the lava would come down. Well, we first moved there, we thought it was trucks coming by our house. And we found out later it was the volcano shaking our house. I thought, it's time to move, honey. I'll offer somebody up in that volcano. And so it always puffs, and then goes off a little bit. Well, show the next picture. This right here is that volcano going on. It's 11 miles from my house. And so, well, it was, you know, and I'm making a little bit light of it, but it was really, this was back in June, and it really erupted. And what happened was, where we live, and you saw the volcano, and where we live, the crater is on the other side, so it puffs up smoke, and a little bit of lava will come down, but then the ash goes the other way. Well, it blew up on this side, on our side, a little bit lower, and all the little villages around the volcano that were there are no longer there. And there was one village that had over 1,000 homes, and all of them but 100 of the homes survived. People lost their lives. It was just, I mean, devastating. It was really, really devastating. And so we went in, and we did some outreaches with food and things like that. We went to several villages where they weren't affected, but they couldn't get food because there was no food around. The trucks couldn't get up there to deliver food to the stores and stuff. And so we did some outreaches. But in October, I just felt like I needed to do more. And you saw in the video, one of the things that we do is that we do outreaches, and we build homes for those that are in need. We go up to the villages, and they live in just like corn stalk, dried walls, and dirt floors. We tear that down, and we put in what we would think is a storage building in our backyard. But we put in this building, and we give them, you know, a hutch and beds and clothing and things like that. Well, I had it in my heart to do it with a family that lost everything. And through another pastor friend of mine, we found a family that they can't go back up to that area. The government won't let them build anymore. So they lost their home. Thank God they didn't lose their lives, but they lost everything. And so if you look to the next picture, and I'm telling you this, just letting you know what we're doing, not bragging on us. I'm bragging on the goodness of God. Amen. And so this is a family that we found, and they had bought a house and a piece of land, and it literally, it's probably from here right there is how big their land is. And they're actually buying it from a friend. And there's nothing there. There's no running water. There's nothing. And we found them. And so we went in and said, we're going to build you a home. And I said, you're going to build us a home? Why would you build us a home? I said, because God loves you and he wants to show you his love. And so we went in and built them this home. And my wife and I and my new son-in-law, because I put him to work. Hallelujah. I'm going to put you to work, man. Hallelujah. Praise God. Got to work for me 7 years. No, I'm joking. Then 7 more years, because you got my own daughter already. But we just got a few graduates of ours, and we usually takes 2 days. It takes a week to build a home, but with teams, we do it in 2 days. But we just did it in 1 day. We just knocked it out. And so we gave them this home, and the mom right here was born again, and the dad wasn't. And so when we give them a home, and you know, if you go up to the next picture, and we give them a home, and my wife's, and that's one of our translators, my wife is there, out there. And so we show them the beds and the hutches, and they didn't know any of that. They were getting any of that to that day. We told them to give them a home, but they didn't know what it meant. And so we're telling them this, and she's like, why would you do this? And so we dedicate the home, we pray over it, and they said, why would you? I said, because God loves you. We didn't bring this home to you. God did. And he loves you, and he cares for you. And she knew Jesus, but her husband and her older son did not. And we dedicated the home. They got born again. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's what it's all about. Amen. Just showing Jesus. I just wanted to help them with a home that they had lost everything. It looks like a war zone where a bomb went off. And so we just wanted to reach out. And again, it was just something we did out of our ministry because we wanted to bless them. Let's go to the next one. And there and I, we live in Antigua, and we're just about an hour outside of Guatemala City. 3 years ago, Rhema Bible Training Center came in to Guatemala City, and so my wife and I, my daughter, we go on a regular basis, and then we graduated our school in October. That weekend, I went to Rhema and spoke, and then the next week, we went and built that house. And so it's just an opportunity we have that we can bless their students there, and it kind of multiplies our ministry. Let's go to the next one. And how many have ever heard of a minister by the name of Mark Hankins? This minister in Louisiana, he takes my sermons and preaches them. But I walk in love and forgive. Then he had the audacity to put them in book form. I thought, wow. No, not really. But Mark has given me the permission to publish all of his books in Spanish. No string. He just given me permission. And not only that, he sent me the files of the books already translated into Spanish. So all I got to do is translate, get them printed there in Guatemala. And so this year, we had them last year, but we couldn't do anything with it. So this year, we printed this book in Spanish. And so when we graduated our school, we gave every one of our students that book as a graduation present. Then when I went to Rhema to preach, we gave them everybody that book. And now Rhema is going to use that book. They're going to get it from us and use it in their school. And then starting next year, we'll use this book in our school. And then we've got two or three we're going to try to do next year. But it's just it's just part of what we do is just trying to help people with the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Now let's go to, I think I have one more and that's it. Everybody say, ah. I told you earlier, I come back to the States and I hit the ground running mid-November, and I left Guatemala and I flew into Orlando and I rented a car and I drove up about an hour north of Orlando, and I go to this church every year on the Sunday morning, and when I was there, this family greeted me and they said, last year when you were here, you prayed for people. I had a word of knowledge, prayed for people that wanted to have a baby, and three couples came up. And this is one of the couples. I prayed for them to have a baby. And there's the baby. Hallelujah. Praise God. There were two other couples that I didn't get a picture of them. I saw them, but they left before I get a picture. And I remember it now. I forgot all about it. And I said, how many want a baby? And all the ladies, a few ladies came up, and their husbands came up. And there was a few ladies that went back to the back of the church. They didn't want any overflow. Oh, praise the Lord. Your pastor, he just gets on me sometimes. He just, Anyway, everybody say, Jesus
is Lord.
Say, I love Jesus.
I love Jesus.
And I like coffee. We do have coffee back there in the foyer out there, and it just helps us with our traveling expenses. They haven't let me yet fly the friendliest guys for free. We're believing that's going to come a day where they will let me, but we like air miles. And so, but anyway, this just helps us with our traveling expenses. And so it's only $200 a bag. There is a scripture that says the Lord helps those who helps them. No, it doesn't really. Thus says Harry. But no, it's only $18. Now, how good is that? From 200 to 18. Yeah, I mean, everybody can buy one for your enemies. It's a Christmas sale. So buy it from your friends, your family, your enemies, and they won't be your enemies anymore. It's out in the foyer. It's only $18. Do you drink coffee?
Oh, yeah.
You do drink coffee. Okay. I couldn't remember. You drink coffee? Oh, okay. Okay. There you go.
Thank you.
Now it's whole bean. It's out there in the foyer. Everybody say, Jesus is Lord.
Jesus is Lord.
Hallelujah. So go ahead and stand up to your feet. I've got just a few things I want to share with you tonight, and then we'll pray for you. And then we'll let you go home. When's your Christmas party? You have a Christmas party usually. Are you doing that this year? You already had it. Say, I was on the wrong Wednesday. I usually come for the party.
Happy birthday Jesus party is next Wednesday for the kids.
Oh, for the kids.
Happy birthday Jesus.
That's what I'm thinking. Next Wednesday.
Yeah.
Oh, I'll stay over. I'll just stay.
Stay over. We have coffee.
We got coffee. You don't, man, we have a conversation, do you? Okay. Lift your hands. Father, we thank you. Oh, we magnify you, Lord. You're so good.
Yes.
Thank you, Father. It's such an honor and a privilege to love you, to serve you, to worship you. Father God, we thank you for this church. We thank you for the congregation, for every person that is involved in this church, Father God. Good things are happening through this place and in this place. And I prophesy, Father God, 2019 is going to be their best year ever. More people, more anointing, more vision, more increase, more abundance in the mighty name of more young people coming to the kingdom of God, more boys and girls being born again. The kingdom of God will advance in this area. In this area, there'll be a great outpouring, a flood of your spirit, Father God. Thank you for your anointing, Father God. Thank you for these pastors, Father God. I thank you, Father God. Now, Father, we come before you to receive of you. We come before you to receive of your word. Thank you, Father God, for speaking to us corporately and speaking to us individually. Speak to us, Lord. I don't know what everybody needs. I don't know what they're facing. But, Father, I pray right now that you speak to them. Use the words that I speak to speak a word into their heart. Father, you have permission. I yield to you, Lord. Your will be done. Minister, strengthen, heal, deliver, and set free by the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit. I give you the glory. I give you the honor. Everybody said?
Amen.
Everybody say, let it be.
Let it be.
Look at my three chairs. They're getting, okay, I'll call. You can be seated. You can be seated. I don't need them right this moment, so I'll call them. Now, go with me to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to read starting in verse 2. Now, your pastor said we can go to midnight. They didn't say anything. Oh. I probably told this before, but I was in Cheyenne, Wyoming. Pastor friend of mine, you know, you have to ask, how, you know, when do you want it back and how long to go? And most pastors are like, well, just take your liberty. No, 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 no. You know, you got to know when to fold them and when to walk away. I mean, you got to know when to stop. You know, blessed is the short-winded, he shall be invited back. You know, so you got to know. And the pastor said, well, Harry, you can go as long as you want Sunday morning. He said, but at noon, we're leaving. I thought, okay. I will quit before noon then. Ephesians chapter 1. Look at verse 2. It says, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be God our Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. According, he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated unto us adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise and the glory of his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved. Everybody say amen. Now, I want you to back up to verse 6 again, and I want to read that last part of that verse. And it says, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved. What does that mean, that we've been accepted into the beloved? That means if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are part of God's family right now. You don't have to wait till you get to heaven to be a child of God. If you've received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've been accepted into God's own family. He is your Father, and you are his child. Everybody say, I am. A child of God. And many people in the body of Christ, they understand that they've received Jesus as their Lord and Savior, but sometimes they don't understand or accept the revelation that he is my Father and I am his child. I belong to God and I've been placed into the family of God. Amen? Amen. Now, keep your place here and we'll come right back here. And we're going to look at 1 John chapter 3. And we're going to look at verse 1. It says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called what? What does God call you? He calls you his child. He calls you his son. He calls you his daughter. God claims you in his family. Now, I know that sometimes we have that uncle that we're not really sure we want to claim. Or maybe we're that relative. Somebody wants to claim us. You shake any tree hard enough, it's some nuts going to fall out. But God claims me. Everybody say, God claims me. He calls me his child. Now, my daughter, and I have four kids, three boys. One daughter, three boys. The girls don't count. I think you need to go sit over here. But my boys and I, we like the movies, Star Wars and Star Trek and sci-fi movies. And if you don't like that, I'll pray for you at the end of the service. I'm just joking. But we do. We like those kind of movies. And my daughter has never really understood them. She tried, but she can't get the concept of them. But my boys and I, we love them. And so something a little bit cheesy that we would do when they were growing up, and I even still do it today to my daughter. The boys are kind of, you know, like, they're not cool with it anymore. But my daughter is. And so even when she was little, now I'll call her up on the phone, or I'll be traveling, and I'll call her, and I'll, you know, she'll answer the phone, hello, and I'll go, you know that first movie, Darth Vader? You got me? If you don't, somebody else will explain it to you. I go, I am your father. She goes, no! It's when Luke found out that Darth Vader, the evil Darth Vader, was his dad. And then she'll call back, my daughter will call back, and I am your daughter. I can hear the voice of God from heaven saying that he is your father. Yes. He's claiming you as his son and daughter. I don't know about you, but that really excites me, that my God claims me as his very own. I am. Yeah, I'm a U.S. citizen. I live in Guatemala, but my citizenship really is in heaven. He is my father. When I get to heaven, he'll be no more my father than he is right now. I'll be no more his son when I get to heaven than I am right now. I'm part of God's family right now. Amen? Yes. Now, look at this rest of this next verse. It says, it said that we should be called the sons of God. I mean, you know, God claims you. He calls you his son. And in verse 2, it says, beloved, now we are sons of God. Everybody say, now. I'm not waiting till I arrive to a certain level spiritually. I'm not waiting till I get to, you know, a little bit more mature. No, right now, the moment you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he's placed you into his family. It's not conditional if you do this or if you don't do this. And people say, well, I'm not worthy. I've made mistakes. I've messed up. I mean, God is not looking at our mistakes. He's looking at the blood of Jesus. And that blood has cleansed you. That blood has forgiven you. And that blood has placed you into the kingdom of his dear son. Amen. You look at the story of the prodigal son. We won't take time to turn there, but you look at the story of the prodigal son. The son took his father's inheritance and went out and spent his inheritance on, the Bible says, riotous living. And really, it was worldly living, carnal living, fleshly living. And then he ended up feeding pigs. Then he came to himself and thought, wait a minute. My father, in his house, he has servants. And his servants eat better than I'm eating. His servants are treated better than I'm being treated. I'm not worthy to be called a son anymore. I'm going to go to my father, and I'm going to ask him, just let me be a servant. And if you read the Bible, it's a good thing to read the Bible. If you read the Bible says when the son went to the father saw him afar off, and what did he do? The Bible says he ran to his son. He hugged his son. He embraced his son. He loved his son. Why? Because his son was lost, but his son is home. And the son said, no, wait a minute, Dad, wait a minute. I'm not worthy any longer to be called your son. I've messed up. I've blown it. I've wasted your money. I've embarrassed you, and I embarrassed myself. I'm not worthy. Just make me a servant. And if you read the Bible, the father didn't even acknowledge what the son said. didn't even say anything. Why? Because he saw him as a son. And too many times we in the body of Christ, we know that we're sanctified. We know that we're redeemed. But sometimes we look at our works and we look at our shortcomings and we look at our mistakes and we think, well, I'm not worthy to be his child. It's not based on our goodness. It's based on his goodness. The password into his kingdom is not my works. And too many times we're trying to work our way, and we know that we're word of faith. We know that we believe the Bible, but sometimes we're trying to work our way, and we don't think, well, maybe someday I'll be good enough to be in his family. No, no, honey, you are good enough right now because he declared you worthy. Now, with all the new technology that we have, it's wonderful. I mean, you got iPhones and you can instant communication. It's good and it's bad. Because people, you can't hide sometimes. They want to answer right then, you know. And so you just got to turn your phone off and hide. But, you know, you got all these good technology, and now you can even got on your phone, you have the app to get in your bank account. You take a picture of a check, and I got your money. Just that quick. I love technology. I mean, it's just so cool. I mean, I just take a picture of it, and I got your money, honey. But the other day, I was somewhere, and I was on my computer, and I was trying to log into my bank account. And, you know, you got to have the password to log in on your computer. And I typed, and I'm embarrassed to say this, and it said, access denied, access denied, access. I thought, why? I got the right password. I have the right, it's my money. Let me have my money. And then I went through the process, you know, where they email you the link and you got to go in and change the password. And so I found my briefcase later and I got my little information where my password's, and I thought, oh, I didn't have the right password. One little letter or one little number off makes a whole bunch of difference. Amen. How many know, many people in the body of Christ, they've been trying to come into God's family based on their performance and how wonderful and how good they are. I mean, no, it's not based on what I've done. It's not based on how good I am. It's based on how good God is. He has qualified me. He's given me access to come into his family. It's not based on anything that we do. Say amen. Now, go back with me over there to Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to look at a few things here. It says in Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to look at verse 5. It says, having predestinated us unto adoption of children by Jesus Christ. Now, that word adoption is a powerful thing. How many know you've been placed into God's family? You've been put into God's family, and it's not because of your works. It's because of Jesus' work, and God doesn't look at you as a second-class citizen or a stepchild. He looks at you as his very own child. Now, to us, adoption is very special. My mother-in-law was adopted. And so it's really cool to us. It's the coolest thing in the world to me when a family goes outside of their family and brings somebody into their family. I mean, that's a very cool thing to me. And so my wife and I, you know, we probably would have adopted, you know, because we couldn't have kids. And we prayed and believed God. And then we got, you know, our daughter. Hallelujah. And then we got three boys, you know. And the fourth child was a, uh-oh. Okay. Lord, that prayer, stop. I never prayed that prayers won't be answered, but Lord, that's enough. No mas. That prayer worked. Hallelujah, praise God. But we probably would have adopted our fourth, but we didn't want five, so we didn't. You got to know your limits. Hallelujah, praise God. But you know, it's special to us. And they tell me, and I don't know, maybe it's changed, and maybe laws have changed a little bit, but they tell me that if you adopt a child, that you can't un-adopt that child. That legally, you are bound to that child. You can't disown that child. To me, that ought to give all of us security. That he'll never leave us or never forsake us. He'll never abandon us. And it's not based on my performance. And you know, we've all experienced rejection. We've all been rejected. We've all been pushed aside. And we all want to belong. And sometimes that fear of rejection
We can even bring it even to our relationship with God. And we can look at God and think, is he going to do something? Am I going to do something that's going to make God reject me? Now listen to me. God loves us. He'll never abandon us. And he won't excommunicate us from his family. Now our actions sometimes won't please him, but he will always call you his child. Amen. He will always claim you. Now I've read that, I quoted that scripture, but I want to read it to you. Hebrews chapter 13. Verse 5 says, the last part of that verse says, I'll never leave thee nor forsake thee. The Amplified Bible says it this way. I will never, under any circumstance, desert you, nor give up, nor let you with, or leave you without support. Nor will I in any degree leave you helpless. Nor will I forsake you or let down or release my hold upon you. I mean, God is not going to let go of you. You are his child, and he claims you. Now, I've got some good news, well, exciting news, you know, maybe not good news, but, you know, for you, but it's exciting news for me. I'm going to be a grandpa. Hallelujah, praise God. And my daughter and them got married, and so they decided they want to have children right away. My wife and I couldn't have kids. We prayed for 7 years, and Danielle came along, so she thought, well, we need to start. And so they started and had no problem. So I'm going to be a grandpa, and I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to be one of those grandpas. Okay? So social media, if you don't like it, just unfriend me. Because I'm going to put pictures, and I'm going to brag about my granddaughter. I call it a granddaughter. My wife says, the Lord told her that we're having a grandson. I said, well, Jesus appeared to me. He walked into my room. He had a white cloth on with a gray shaft. I said, somebody's going to be, no. Then somebody, I told somebody that, and they said, no, he's going to have twins. could be. But I want to let you know right now, I'm going to be obnoxious. I'm going to post this baby. I mean, it's going to be just be the baby's wall on Facebook. I heard Mark Hankin say this. If God had a refrigerator in heaven, your picture would be on it. Yes. Why? Because you are his family. You are his heart. Amen? Say amen. Amen. So when I go through the airport and the security people at TSA ask me, how's your day doing? Well, my day's doing great. Want to see a picture of my granddaughter? Everybody say, I am a child of God. Say, he is my father. Say, I am a child of God. Turn to your neighbor and say, you are a child of God. Now, can I use you for an illustration? Uh-huh. Okay, come on up here. Okay, see these? I need a couple guys to put these three chairs right across there. You stay with me. You stay with me. Three guys right there. You got three chairs? Okay, uno, dos. Just right there on that carpet right there. I told you we're going to go to midnight. I don't remember. Joey, is that your name?
Joe.
Is it Joey or Joe?
Well, mom's here, so Joseph.
Joseph. Who's your mom? Joseph. Oh, Joseph. Okay. That's right, Joseph. yeah, we got a son named Matthew. Don't you call him Matt. Because he's Matthew. So, Joseph.
Yeah.
Okay, I got to get it right. Now, everybody say, hi, Joseph.
Hi, Joseph.
Mama says it's Joseph. So, hi, Joseph.
Hi, Joseph.
Now, for illustration, he is no longer Joseph. He is God. Everybody say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So when you go home tonight, you got to bow in the presence of the Lord. Come on up here, God. I'm going to give you a seat of honor. I want you to sit. We're going to pull these back just a little. I want you to sit right there in the middle. I'm telling God what to do. That's what most Christians do.
Yeah.
Just telling you. Now, because I am his child and he is my father, membership, I'm in his family, membership has its privileges. And what is that slogan? American Express, I think. Membership has its privileges. Because he is my father, I am his child, I get benefits. Everybody say benefits.
Benefits.
Too many times we in the body of Christ are not making full access
to the privileges and benefits that we've been given as a son and daughter. We're still wrestling if I'm a son. Well, yeah, maybe. No, I don't feel like it. No, honey. No matter if you feel like it or not, you are God's son. You are God's child. You are in the family. And with that membership comes privileges. Now, years ago, I worked for a company for 2 years and did not know. Nobody told me that I had benefits. I could go to the dentist twice a year. And nobody told me. And I could pay vacation. They were going to pay me to get rid of me. And nobody told me. Worked there for 2 years. How many know you are a child of God? Everybody say, I am. A child of God. And with that membership into his family, there are blessings that have been given to you. The Bible says he daily loads us with benefits. Amen? Now, I met my wife at Rhema Bridal Training Center in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And so we met there, and she was from Colorado. And so I knew her folks, but I didn't know the rest of the family. So we flew out over spring break to meet the rest of the family. She's bringing a boy home. Rest of the family. And so we're driving around in Longmont, Colorado, and I noticed the car needed some gas. And so I said, Karen, we need to get some gas. She said, well, go to my dad's shop. He had a construction company. And she said, go to my dad's shop. He has gas pumps there. And you can get gas. I said, okay. So I pulled into the shop, and there was. It was a gas pump, like a gas station, a pump. And so we pulled up. She said, get some gas. And so I put gas in the car. We were driving. And she got in the car, and she said, let's go. I said, well, don't we need to pay for your gas? She said, no. What's my daddy's is mine. I thought, oh, I like that. I like that. She said, what's my daddy's is mine. She said, he's my father, and I'm his child. What he's got, I got. Hallelujah. I said, well, can we go get my car and fill my car up? She said, you're not family yet. Everybody say, membership has its privileges. Now, I told you to go to the scripture, so go there. Hebrews chapter 4. And for time's sake, we're going to go to verse 16. How you doing up there, God?
I'm good.
You good? Okay. Am I okay, doing okay? When God say you're doing okay, you're doing okay. Oh, glory to God. Look at verse 16. Just remember the bow when he gets home. Look at she rolling her eyes. Oh, Lord help us. Look at verse 16. Everybody say, let us. Now, when I say let us, you say that means me. Okay? No, I didn't say it yet. Come on now. Let us.
That means me.
Oh, they're so good. So let's try it one more time. Let us.
That means me.
Therefore come. What's it?
Boldly.
What?
Boldly.
Into the throne of
grace.
That we may obtain
mercy.
And find what? To what?
Help.
In time of need. One of the privileges that I have as being a child of God is I've been invited into the very presence of God. I can come into his presence when I have a problem, when I have a difficulty, when things are not going the way that I want them to go, when this world that we live in is being dark and confusion. I've got an answer. I've got a source that knows every answer that I need that I'm facing. I mean, you and I have been invited to come into his presence. Now, it's an honor and a privilege to be in his family. It's such a privilege and an honor. And I just sit there and think about it some days. I am his child. I am his child. Sometimes we go through identity crisis. But how many know, you're not an outcast. You're not an outsider. You belong to the Most High God. He is your father. And listen to me. Everybody say, he's a good God.
He's a good father.
Now, you and I have been invited to come into the presence of God. And some believers believe that they're not worthy to come to be a part of his family. And they may get past that, and they may accept that they're part of his family. But sometimes, believers, Christians, us, we ends,
sometimes don't understand that we've also been invited to come into His presence and get our needs met. And too many times we're trying to carry the load, the burden, the hurts, the rejection, the fears, the concerns on ourselves. And I'm going to tell you right now, you were never designed to carry it yourself. You weren't made to carry the cares. He was made to carry the cares. And too many Christians, if they accept their identity that they're in the family, sometimes they don't want to accept that they can come to the Father. And they say, well, I'm not worthy. I mean, no, you're not worthy to be in the kingdom, but He's made you in His kingdom. And you're worthy to come in His presence. I'm not coming based on what I've done. I'm coming based on the blood of Jesus. His blood has given me access where I can come to the Father. Amen. And I don't know what you're facing. I don't know problems, the difficulty, the things that are coming against you. And I don't know if you've even made mistakes. I mean, the Father is not going to, listen to me, the Father is not going to put condemnation upon you. He's not going to condemn you. He's not going to put shame on you. I've never gone in His presence where He condemned me. Now, I've gone in His presence where He brought conviction. Now, there's a difference. Condemnation says, shame on you, shame on you. You've done wrong and there's no hope. That's condemnation. Conviction says, you did wrong. That wasn't right. But I've got forgiveness and there's hope and there's healing and there's future for you. I've never gone in His presence where He's given me a problem. Every time that I've gone in His presence, He's poured in the oil and the wine and the forgiveness and the love and the help. Can I give you a little secret of how to live victorious in life? And I know that we have authority, and I know we can come against darkness and come against things, but let's be real. We live in a world that's really cold and mean, and we do face rejection. How we overcome is not trying to carry it, but coming to the Father and giving it to Him. The Bible says, cast all your cares upon Him. And just the other day, I had a situation happen. Nothing really earth devastating, but it was just a little bit of a rejection. Just a little bit of rejection. And I have to say, it bothered me. And I came to the Father. And I said, Lord, I'm just thankful that You're my Father. That You'll never leave me. That You'll never forsake me. And you know what He did? He poured in the oil and the wine. And He healed that little hurt. And again, it wasn't anything spectacular. But how many know if it touches you, it touches God? Sometimes we think they have to be the big things, No, honey. It's the little foxes that spoil the vine. Sometimes those little things get in our heart and we start carrying those things. And before you know it, they turn into a really big problem. And so I just came into God's presence and I said, Lord, I had this. And He says, I understand. And there's no condemnation and no guilt. Now let me read this to you. Everybody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When I went to Raymond, before I went to Raymond, I went to another Bible college there in Tulsa. And it was 1979. And I'm showing my age just a little bit. I'm only 25. Don't you laugh. 1979. Tulsa. They had a Sunshine Concert. How many remember the Imperials? Nobody remembers the Imperials. You remember the Imperials?
No.
You never heard of the Imperials?
I've heard of them.
You've heard of them. Big singing group, big singing group. And so there was all kinds of groups there. Really nice concert. Chris Christian, at that time, a record producer. I think he came out with one album, but record producer. And he came out during intermission. He came out with this new talent. And he said, I want to introduce you a new talent, no records, just somebody that I want to introduce you to. I'm a producer. And she came out with a 12-string Ovation guitar and a Diet Coke. And her name was Amy Grant. I remember her name, Amy Grant. Okay, now we got a little bit more people. But this is one of the songs that she sang that night. She said, it's a cold world that we're walking through. Lay down the burdens of your heart. Lay down the burdens of your heart. I know you'll never miss it. Show your daddy where it hurts, and let your daddy kiss it. We have a tremendous privilege and honor to be in God's family. And it's not just that he just wants us in his family. He really cares for you and me. He's adopted us and he calls us his very own children. And he's concerned about everything that touches our life. And he's asking you to come into his presence. And if you have situations, problems, difficulties, whatever it may be, if you messed up, don't run away from God. Run to God and there'll be forgiveness in his presence. Amen. Now, let me just take this up a notch. Can I do that? Just stay right there, Don. It's a joy and an honor to be in his family. And it's a joy and an honor to come in his presence and get my needs met. But let's take it up just a notch. Not only can I come into his presence and get my needs met, I can come into his presence and get his needs met. As a son and daughter, as a child of the Most High God, I can come and he'll minister to me. And sometimes we come into his presence and he pours in the oil and the wine and forgiveness and healing, and we feel better because in his presence there's fullness of joy. And we leave his presence because we have the answer. It's wonderful, it's great. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-yay, I have everything I need. Oh, it's so good. And we leave his presence, and God says, but, can you, I have. And I believe it's a greater privilege and a greater honor not just to come and get my needs met, but to come and say, Lord, what can I do for you? Is there something that you need? Is there something in your heart that you're looking to do in this earth? And then sometimes we wrestle with the issue, well, I'm not worthy to be used by God. God uses people to do, imperfect people, to do his perfect work. Amen. You qualify, you're in his family, and you qualify. The Bible says you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood that should show forth the praises of him who's called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, into his kingdom. You are brought into the kingdom of God, not just to get your needs met, but you are called into the kingdom of God to get his needs met. And I don't know what it is. Maybe it's just my age. And this year, I've just been coming in his presence, and he's so good, and he's so wonderful. I can come in his presence, and I get encouragement, I get strength, and I get my needs met, and he supplies everything that I need. Man's not my source, God is my source, and it's so good. But I've just been spending time in his presence and saying, Lord, what can I do for you? And I haven't done it perfectly, but I've always had the heart, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. But it's just this year, I just don't know. It's just been stirring in my heart. Lord, I don't want to run my race. I want to run your race. Is there things that you have that you want done that maybe somebody's not doing? The Bible says he sought for a man that he would stand in the gap and make up the hedge. But he could not find any. God is looking for people that will say, here am I, Lord, use me. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done in this earth. Now, I'm from L.A., Lower Arkansas. And there was a young man that I knew, and his dad had three restaurants in little towns, little communities, little towns around our, you know, our down in South Arkansas. And I've never heard of Western Sizzler. Like, you know, it's like a bonanza, you know, kind of a all steak eat. And he had a couple of those restaurants. And the young man, the son, would eat at his dad's restaurant. Pay for it, not at all. Just eat at his restaurant, come in and out, and tell the cook what he wanted. Then he went off to college. And, you know, you will go for an education, but mama and daddy send you to grow up a little bit. And hopefully that will happen, education and the growing up a little bit. Well, this young man came back that next summer. And he went to his dad and said, Dad, all these years, you've done really, been really good to me. And I've eaten at your restaurant, and you just give me anything I want. So this summer, I'm going to come, and I'm going to work for you. Whatever you need done, that's what I'll do. And you don't have to pay me. If there's jobs, If there's things that maybe you can't get done, or your employees can't get done, or little jobs that you think are too little for you, not very good for your employees to do, I'll do those jobs. Just whatever, I'm your go-to guy. And if I eat anything at your restaurant, I'm going to pay for it because I want to give back to you. How many know that young man grew up? And I believe it's time in the body of Christ that we have that same maturity, that we grow up. God wants to minister to us, and He is not going to stop ministering to us. He is our Father. He can't help it. He is a good God that does good things for His children. Amen? It's not just what He does. It's who He is. He's a good Father. Everybody say, He's a good Father. But it's our job to say, Lord, what can I do for you? I want to be that go-to guy. Is there things that you need accomplished? Is there things that you need done? You just tell me, Lord, and I'll do it. If I can't do it, I'll make it happen. I'll do something. Whatever I can do, I'm going to see it's going to happen. I'm going to sacrifice. I'm going to give. I'm going to do whatever I can to carry out your will and your plan. Everybody say amen. Amen. Now, if you notice, I got to close. If you notice, there's three chairs. What is the third chair for? The third chair is for you. The Father is calling you into His presence. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know the hurts, the rejection, the fear. I don't know the things that are bothering you. I don't know what kind of wisdom that you need. I don't know what you're facing. And I couldn't really meet your need. But I know somebody that knows what you're facing and can meet your need. The Father knows all about you, and He wants you to come to Him and get your need met. Everybody say, God is my source. Say it again. Say, God is my source. And He's wanting us to come to Him and get our needs met. Now, it's a little bit of a joke, but when you come into His presence, I'm going to be here. Because I'm going to be in His presence. Say amen. Amen. Now, I got one last scripture, and I'm going to let you go. Let you leave and go home. Everybody say, ah. Philippians chapter 2. The Apostle Paul is talking here in Philippians chapter 2. And he says, but I trust, verse 20, he says, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy shortly unto you, that I also may be a good comfort when I know your state. Look at verse 21. For I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. Now listen to this. The Spirit of God is speaking through the Apostle Paul, and he's telling the church, I have no man like-minded who will naturally care for your state. Verse 22, for all seek their own and not the things which are Jesus Christ. To me, that's a very bad statement, that everybody else is seeking their own. I want to be the vessel that God can use. I want to invite you. This seat is for you. The Father is calling you. And He's saying, come and I will minister unto you. But also the Father's calling because He needs you. There's gifts. There's talents. There's things on the inside of you. Your gifts, your callings, your talents are different than mine. But God has things that He wants you to do through your life. This church needs your talent, needs your gift, needs your resources, needs your ability. This church needs you. You don't just come and get blessed. You come and be a part because God's glory and God's power wants to be flowed through your life. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, God. You can be seated. Now, I'm going to dethrone Him, okay? You can give me an offering later. Now, one last scripture. I told you that just a minute ago, didn't I? Sorry. Psalms 25. I'm sorry. Psalms 25. I'm trying to condense. So, look at verse 14. The secrets of the Lord is with them that fear Him. He will show them His covenant. One translation says, the Lord confides in those who fear Him. He will make His covenant known to them. Now that word fear is not like you would have the boogeyman or the monster under your bed or a snake. That's not what it's talking about. I don't fear God. He's my Father. I'm not scared of God. I have a reverence before God, a holy awe before God, but I'm not scared of God. So how many know, how many have an awe of God, a respect, a fear? So how many know you don't tell everybody your secrets? Well, you shouldn't tell everybody your secrets. Just ask Joseph. You shouldn't tell everybody your secrets. You tell your secrets to people that are close to you. And I believe if we'll spend time in his presence, saying, Lord, what would you have me to do? I mean, oh, God has missions. He has things that he's wanting us to do on this earth. And again, what he's called me to do may not be what he's called you to do. But let me tell you this. We want the will of God here on this earth. Amen. Go ahead and stand up to your feet. And I want you to lift your hands right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, here we are. We're your servants. Use us for your glory. Use us, Father.